So some of the things that I look for depends on the type of season. Right now, obviously, it's the middle of January, so we're still in winter. Actually, I haven't been doing too good in snowboarding jackets this year. Usually I do, but I'll take a look through their jackets, see if I can find any higher ticket items, LL Bean, any kind of Nike dry fit, stuff like that. I check their hats as well, and then I kind of make my way around to the shoes. Shoes are always a no-brainer as far as profits are concerned, but it just kind of depends on check your comps. So I'll always fill up my basket first before I won't go item by item and look it up individually. I'll fill my cart on things that I think are decent, and then I'll just do one round of looking everything up. And then I put my stuff back. I don't hand it to the associates at the checkout counter, because that's a nonsense move to do. That's a rookie move. Let's go check their shoes. So typically, I'll check top racks first for boots. Look for boots like Timberland, Danner. Any kind of boots that might stick out as far as high quality leather, stitching. Also cowboy boots do really well for me. I look for Justin's, Ariat's, other type of brands like that. And then I look at their running shoes. So it's the beginning of the year. Everybody's starting on their New Year's resolution, so everybody's trying to lose weight. So people are into buying athletic equipment, and that means jogging pants, sweaters, dry fit, running shoes. So I look for Asics, Nikes, Brooks, other brands like that, and I'll check the comps on them, but usually they do fairly well, and a lot of people are buying stuff right now trying to get back into the flow of things. So the more you know your seasons, think outside the box, the better off you'll be. Yeah, so here we go. These obviously are not your typical boots. Some decent stitching going on here. These are actually Wranglers. They're $20, but they're in fairly decent condition. Toes are scraped up a little bit, nothing bad. Insoles look good. Always check for wear. So see right here? This would be a deal breaker for me. See how it's worn down all the way to the nail? You can get them resold, but I don't put that much time into it. I'm all about moving things quickly. So because that indent right there in the holes, these are a pass. Jordan 1s. They're U size, 6U. Probably 10 or 12 bucks. Yeah, $12. I'm pretty confident the comps in these will be probably around the $40 range. So minus shipping, which will be $10 to $12 depending. I'm looking at about a $15 profit margin, give or take. I'll look up the comps anyway. I like to be pleasantly surprised. So these are pretty decent. They're called Newtons. These usually sell for me about $25 to $30 range. I'm sorry, these are Sauconys. We've got different insoles in them, I'm sorry. Their Sauconys are size 13. Treads okay. They're $10. Mirage 2. Look these up as well. I'm thinking these are about a $35 shoe. Minus shipping, you're only looking at basically doubling your money. That doesn't work for me. But I'll look them up anyway. Some New Balance French foam. I like the colorway for girls. It's kind of a teal color, aqua, the neon. Just need a good clean, good insoles. I like that. If you can still read the writing on the inside, they're not super heavily used. Size 6.5. I usually like to stick between size 7 and size 9.5 to 10 in women's. Like I said, because it's kind of the beginning of the year, people are looking for new running equipment and stuff, there's, I think, going to be a lot more buyers than usual. So for $10, these are okay. Don't you guys be sleeping on Crocs either. I was a super hater on Crocs until I started wearing them and my back problems went away. These ones have like no tread left. You can pick these up for under $5. Get them. $12 on these two. These are $12. They're a little bit higher than I like to spend on them. Pretty clean. Nike Free Trainers. They're size 8.5, which is a good size. So I'll keep them cruising, keep them cruising. Crocs, they're $10. It's a little too much. Mostly one Croc. Not too bad. The Rockin' Republic. Like the high mids here. It seems to be in good condition. Always make sure you check the insides. The leather's perimeter. Always check conditions on shoes. Alright. Add duct tape, keep them together. That's a no go. So these are pretty cool. Pretty high made leather. Turn them over. Made in Italy. So I'll definitely be pulling these up. No real wear on the soles, so that's a good sign. They are a size 13, I believe. $8, a pretty good price for dress shoes. Toes are in excellent condition, which is really good. Usually you're gonna get scuffs in the toes the most. And the back of the heels are gonna be worn down super bad, so I'll pull these up and check. Tassels are in good condition. Johnson Murphy, same thing. Toes are really good condition. Couple of splatters there. Those are actually pretty easy to get out with cleaners. Insoles are mint, so they'll do a full spell out. Tread is a lot of tread life. These barely look used. Looks like they probably spilled something on the first night wearing them and then just never wore them again. Get those out, $8. Size 10 men, so good size. I don't do a lot of women's high heels, to be honest. It's just not my forte. I try and research brands a lot, but I always seem to pick ones that never go. If they're Ferragamos, I'll pick them up. What else? I mostly stick to just running shoes for women. That's what I know as far as brands and stuff are concerned, but I'm always learning as well. I also like certain styles, but I'm no woman, so what do I know? Sometimes I do good, but most times. Some Nikes down there. I'm sure anybody who watches this video is seeing a ton of shoes they should be picking up, and I'm just walking right by. But leave a comment down below if you know something, because so I checked the bag section as well. Shout out to Bonafide Hustler on this. I've done really well with bags. I look for higher end brands, Tumi, Hartmann, backpacks, Patagonia, if you can find them. I actually found a Patagonia bag here last month. It was my first Patagonia I've ever found. Bought it for $6, sold it for $55, literally like within 8 hours of listing it, so pretty quick turnaround. I also look for vintage briefcases. I like vintage Samsonite bags. I found a carry-on the other day that still had the lock and keys. The original was probably from like the late 60s, early 70s, but people are looking for certain styles. And some of my best memories growing up as a kid was when I traveled with my folks, and having kind of cool luggage and stuff is kind of a statement piece as well. If you're well traveled, you guys know about that. You want a durable bag that's well made that will last you, and so brands like that seem to do pretty well. So back around, I don't really do backpacks too much unless it's like a Jordan backpack. If you can find like a Patagonia or something like that, sometimes they'll have purses back here as well. Kind of depends. I've been really picking up on the fanny packs lately. Fanny packs seem to be back in. They're trending pretty hardcore right now. So if I find stuff like that, something pretty decent. Golf bags do really well too. People are always transitioning, especially end of the year, beginning of the new year. People are getting new sets of clubs, so they're donating their whole sets, including their bags and everything. So if you find good golf bags, definitely pick those up. They're a plus. Laptop bags can do very well as well, but you have to kind of make sure you check the inner linings so things aren't ripped. No executive or somebody that's in the business world wants the corners of their laptop bag ripped out, so you can actually see the corners of the laptop. Not a good look. Decent briefcase, $7. Always check and make sure if they don't open. Now, I crack these, they're not too hard, they're only 3 digits each, but it takes some time, so it's better if they automatically open. Bullet Cassini, open this like messenger bag, $6. Leather's in really good shape, I don't see any rips or tears. Handles are intact, no rips where the handles are. Zipper seems to be fully functioning. It's not stuck, that's good. If you're ever looking at clothing or luggage, you can zoom in on that. YKK. This is a good brand for zippers. It's almost a guarantee that there's better quality in the actual zipper itself. It's a higher end brand. I don't want to get it wrong, but I believe it's out of China. But if they invest a little bit higher price tag just for the zipper itself, usually means there's quality there. If you look inside, it's pretty pristine. I don't see any major stains. The tag in there, old vintage tag. And then check the corners. Let's see, right there. See how there's kind of a rip there? That's what you don't want. You don't want that leather peeled back and ripping in the corners. So this is a no-go for me. Knockoff Tory Burch. I got excited for a second. This is a Fugazi. Quick way to tell. A high-end purse would not have a made in China tag sticking on like that, first of all. There's Tony Burch and there's Tony Busted. That was Tony Busted. So as far as pants are concerned, I used to make a really good living just off jeans. I like brands. Vintage Levi's do really well for me, especially ones made in the USA. I like brands like Lucky, 7 for All Mankind, women's jeans. I used to do a lot of Hudson jeans, a lot of Seven for Mankind, for All Mankind. Sizes are really important, and to make sure that I don't like frayed jeans, so the bottom of the, where the pant leg cuffs, that's all ripped up. That's a no-go for me. Zara, I started picking up recently. Zara jeans seem to do pretty well for me. I don't like to spend over $10 for jeans. Most jeans you can fit in a legal flat rate envelope and ship them anywhere in the country for under $7. So if you're in for 10, 7 for shipping, call it another $2 for fees. If you're in $19, $20 on the jeans, you gotta be selling them for at least 40 or more, unless you can get jeans for cheaper. My sweet spot's between like $4 and $7 if I can get a decent pair. I turn around selling for like $38 to $45 depending. I always ship legal flat rate. It's very hard to find jeans that'll ship first class, unless you're talking about smaller jeans. Hollister, skinny jeans that are, their material's a little bit lighter. You can sometimes ship those first class if they're under a pound, and then it's like under $5 to ship it anywhere in the country. But the key is, if you're trying to grow, you definitely gotta watch your margins, you guys. You can't take a risk on 5 pairs of jeans that they're only gonna make you $7 to $10, and you're investing that much into the jeans themselves. So if they cost you 10, you're gonna make 7. It's not good margins to start. So if you wanna flip easily and you wanna grow your business, make sure your margins are a lot stronger than that. So you wanna at least minimum double up. Whatever you're spending, you wanna make sure you clear at least that dollar amount after your fees, your shipping, you have an eBay store, shipping supplies, add all that to it, because those are your actual costs, right? So we'll roll through these a little bit. Lucky brand jeans. Ends are a little frayed, not bad. But you can't make money when they're selling jeans for $20 a pop. That's pretty tough. I like new with tag stuff because it's unused. It's 52 by 30. I like bigger sizes as well. They're $10. Wouldn't do 10, but they're regularly $44. The bigger sizes, don't let bigger sizes go. I buy a lot of jeans at Salvation Army for $1 that are size 44 or larger, because those aren't as, they're a lot harder to find out in the wild as far as people going shopping for them. And they might only have a selection of a handful of pairs. So when you can pick those up, especially on the cheap, again, if you can fit them into a legal flat rate envelope, they're a larger pant, so it's sometimes harder to fit in a legal flat rate. So the jeans are 2.5, 3 pounds, you're shipping like maybe from the West Coast to the East Coast, you're looking at $12 to $15 for shipping. If you're buying it for $1, still might be a go, but be careful on shipping costs, because the bigger the pant leg, the heavier the pants weigh, obviously. Wranglers, a lot of new tag Wranglers. These are the same size, 52 by 30. These are 52 by 30. So you could try and bundle them. These are 15, so you're looking at $25 between the two pairs, so $12.50 each. Even if I combined them both and tried to sell them both for $60, minus fees, you could ship them together in probably a flat rate box, it would be $12.85, a medium flat rate. So you'd be in for $37. So you might pocket like $16 after fees. It's no go for me. Levi's, quick pro tip. See this red tag here? It says Levi's. In the Levi tag, if the second letter, which is the letter E, is a capital, that's a really good sign they're high-end jeans. As far as vintage is concerned, most Levi's will have the size on the back. What you wanna look for inside, if I can hold them. No tags on the inside. A button fly is super sought after as far as men's jeans are concerned, so look for those as well. They're $10. It's not too bad. I believe these are like a 32. Super faded, but button flies, definitely look for them. I like 501 jeans. They're a classic Levi look. Again, don't be a douche. Make sure you hang up all your clothes that you're looking through. Don't make it harder on these sales representatives and people that work here. Some people I'll see rip it off and they'll just throw it back on the rack. Come on, put them back. So
what I look for jeans.
I'll go through sweaters as well and kind of do a browse of what I look for in sweaters. Sweaters are huge as far as quality is concerned. A lot of vintage sweaters. You're talking like Pendletons, LL Bean, things like that. Make sure they're not moth-eaten, so it might look great all around. You're checking the tags, checking the comps, they look great, but check for the holes that like the moth-eaten holes. So what I'd like to do is I'll flip the sweater inside out, hold it against the light, and see if anything shines through. It's a lot easier than just trying to see it from the naked eye. A lot of times something looks great here, and then you get back to your house, turn on your lighting, and all of a sudden you find all sorts of flaws that you couldn't, that you didn't find here. It's because you're not checking. Flip through a couple here. I do really good on Field and Stream. Really thick jacket, or thick sweater, full zip, $8. Again, I'm gonna check for any kind of holes, stains on the cuffs, on the elbows. And then I turn it around, make sure there's no huge stains. I'll lay it flat, make sure there's nothing there. It's a size XL, which I like. I like anything large to double XL. Seems like the bigger sizes you can actually get more money for. $8 is not a bad price for this, honestly. Think about picking this up. This is probably like a $25 to $35 sweater. So you figure $8 for the sweater, $6.85 to ship. Fees another $2, so figure in for about $18 altogether. If you're selling it for $25 to $35, looking at doubling your money or tripling your money, it's not too bad. I'm gonna hang on this just to check comps too. I really like Brooks Brothers, super high-end brand. It's got the upgraded cotton as well. It's an extra large. No holes in the pockets, all the buttons are there. I always check on the inside. These tags on the inside are huge. If you're having trouble finding the style, this is where you're gonna find them. Nike's really good about putting inside tags as well. It's gonna have the size, it's gonna have the type, how to treat it, as well as usually a product code as well. So really important to have those. As I can tell, no stains, no holes, cuffs aren't super stretched out, still some good elastic there. Flips all around like a good sweater, $8. Woolrich is a super good brand. $7. I'm gonna pull the comps on this. I just started getting into Woolrich. It seems to sell super fast for me. I like the men's sweaters. They're a little bit thicker. Also, Woolrich like button-up shirts, like Columbia has their PFG. It's kind of like that, like an outdoors type with the vents in the back. It's pretty good. I'm gonna check the comps on this. Comps and Tommy Bahama have kind of fallen a bit lately. I still will pick up their sweaters. This one's got some stains on it. It's a good price, it's only $8, but I don't really do good with stains on it. This is a women's. It's got the embroidery. So again, make sure that you're checking the condition, you guys. You don't want to get something, get home, and then you wash it 10 times and it ain't coming out. Tommy Hilfiger super hot right now. You get the old spell out jeans. It's a double XL. Really like that size. It's got the little embroidered logo here. As far as I can tell, no stains, no holes. Kind of pick that up, kind of a stain right there. Not be too bad though. That inside tag, super important. $8 inside. Excited for a second. That is not old enough to be a World War II pack. Puma Golf. I'll breeze through shirts and, you know, just, I'll try and find the vintage stuff that I think can fetch a good profit if it's cheap enough. I typically don't like to spend more than like $3 or $4 on a shirt, if that. $1 is more my price point, which you can find shirts for $1 all day long at garage sales. In my area particularly, Salvation Army will do like a fill a bag for like 10 bucks. I will roll those as tight as I can roll them. I can fit 20, 30 bags or 30 shirts in one bag for 10 bucks. You're paying like 40, 50 cents a piece. Again, big sizes, if you can find them, it's a pretty decent. Perialis to me isn't really that great of a resale brand. I like their clothing, but it doesn't fetch a big price tag. But this is a 4XL 2. Looks in really good condition. It's a V-neck. $7, which is high for a shirt, given the size. In pretty good condition. I'd pull comps, but it's $7. I don't think it's there, so it's a pass. But look for big sizes. So I'm looking for vintage shirts, bands, old school Disney cartoons, things that we grew up with. I'm an 80s kid, so it's a bunch of peers that are my age that are coming back around that now can afford to pay a little bit extra money to get that shirt that they always wanted or that they grew up and didn't have or remember having. All that stuff is coming back now. Again, just depends on the price though. I will get like Nike dry fit shirts if I can find them cheap enough. Shirts that are kind of unusual that have particular associations. So this, for instance, never heard of the brand, but you can just tell by the stitching and the style it's vintage. This is probably, say, late 80s, early 90s, like Andre Agassi era. Tag is completely washed out, except it does say it's a large, but that style. $6. Just because the style and the colors are so crazy. Nike Air Max 98s are coming out with a bunch of drops right now that are crazy colorways, which is right up that alley. So I'm gonna look comps on this. This is one off, where this might be actually a Poshmark sale. It's just a little bit more acquired taste as far as the coloring is concerned. This has got like Fresh Prince of Bel-Air written all over it. So I'll pick this up and check the comps. You can find the Guess vertical lines striped shirts as well. Those are coming back super, super heavy. Fetch a pretty good amount. I do like Under Armour as well. It's a pickup of a brand called Orbis. It was a pickup until I saw that. Always make sure you check. Price on that's $15, a little high, but Orbis is a good brand. I'm tripping on their prices here lately. Yeah, a little too expensive. Polo, got the nice embroidery. It's a small, I don't like dealing with small shirts, honestly. They're not really a quick sale for me. Some movies have a huge following. You find like original, like 2001 Fast and Furious shirts. Swoop those up. If you find car design shirts, so like anything with Supras, Evos, WRXs, Rally Edition, race, like Indianapolis 500, like race cars, that type of stuff, they have a cult following and usually can fetch pretty high prices, so I keep your eyes out for that. I don't find too much racing style shirts, but I do find a lot of movie style shirts that have affiliates with it, and if you can pick them up for cheap enough, they're super quick turnaround. Nike. When you're checking Nike shirts, especially vintage, you're gonna want to look inside if it has an actual tag, not the tagless shirts. If it's like a dark navy blue color or a white and gray trimmed Nike tag, then it's a vintage Nike tag. You know, 80s, 90s vintage Nike is super tough right now. Fetches some pretty decent prices. Found a couple this year of the navy blues, and was able to make some pretty good money on them. A lot of people just they're cleaning out their closets for New Year's as well. So you might be able to find not only a bunch of vintage items, but you'll find clumps, which will all be the same size. So get used to looking at things in a broader spectrum. Can you, if you made $5 profit on a shirt, is it worth it? No. If you found three of the same size and made 15 or 20, then it might be worth your time. Bundling is huge and everybody wants a deal. They want one shirt in that particular size. Why wouldn't they want three at an even cheaper price? So keep your options open. Don't be limited to just one-offs, and don't be afraid to try new things as far as bundling things together. So that's a Tommy Bahama shirt, size large. It's $4.99, good price. Knockoff Harley Rider shirt. I like Harley Davidson, but not when it's a knockoff. I like anything with music festival, Coachella, Rock the Bells, EDC, anything like that. This is an old Navy shirt, but I like any kind of shirts where you can have something to affiliate a particular type of event. If it's a jazz festival, if it's a rock concert or whatever, people want shirts with that type of musical instruments on it if you can get them cheap enough. Even though it's an old Navy, just say it's a music rock shirt. This one's $2.99. Yes, it's old Navy. Don't knock old Navy. But sometimes I'll take a handful of those and see if I can sell them. If shirts make me laugh out loud, like legitimately, I read it, I start busting up, I will buy them. For the simple fact of if I'm laughing at it, the mass majority I think will too. I think I have an okay sense of humor. Toot my own horn though. Trust data. I don't know, that's just funny to me. Not for $5. But yeah, trust your instincts. '64 Mustang. Anything with vintage cars, somebody's cruising it. It's a neutral color. $4. Check the comps, I'll pop them out. It's probably like an $18 shirt. You can start seeing trends on what's hot, or was hot, I should say. For some reason, cats are on fire lately. Everything is something cat related. That's a no-go for her. Boxing merchandise has been coming back. Legendary fight, if you didn't see it, Pacquiao Mayweather, they were hyping this forever. It's really good condition, looks brand new, looks like it's never been worn. It's a size small, it's $5. I'm getting that for sure. I like women's Misty jeans, studded, big M. Hate that frayed jeans. $20. If you're just starting out, you definitely want to look for items that you can flip for good money, right? And maybe items that you don't even spend that much money on. I think toys and video games and board games, probably some of my biggest turnaround profits. I get board games all the time for like $1, sell them for 25, 30. Some you can sell for a couple hundred. Brands I stick to, I like anything Disney because they're following. Anything Monopoly, but make sure they're complete. Make sure they have their dice, their timers, their cards, things like that. They're pretty easy to look through. After you look what's required or what necessities or pieces come with it, just make sure they're in there. Take a little stroll and see what we can find. Seen it. There's a Disney Seen It. It does really well for me. Heavy, so that's another thing on shipping weight. It's a little bit too wide for a legal flat rate. A flat rate box, which is pretty long to ship. Missing key pieces, that's a no-go. It's a old Nickelodeon from 2002. Not quite vintage. I think 20 years is where it becomes vintage. We're losing drop. I sold 10 to 15 of these this year. It's like a $10 profit margin. $3. I have like three right now. Super important. They have timers, always make sure they got the timers. Instructions is a plus. All four racks are there. Board. On that, it's complete, it's huge too, so it's gonna be expensive to ship, but there's money there to come up. Stuffed animals are another one that are huge, can be huge profit margins. Don't get overwhelmed by seeing huge rows of things you don't know about. A good way to start building your knowledge, pick one row in any Goodwill, Salvation Army, or whatever, and start learning about that particular row. So if it's stuffed animals, spend an hour just pulling up comps on any stuffed animal that looks cool, old, vintage, complete with tags, start to kind of get to know your certain niches, and research is one of the most important things. When people ask me, how do you know about what to flip, and my store is pretty diverse, I have so many different items, I'm not just a niche in one particular item. I like to have variety. For this, for instance, what first got my eye, he's got the year on his actual sweater. He's got the tag, 1989, it was $25. So this bear's 30 years old, he's in super good condition. He's had some accidents, he's 30 years old, give him a break. The tag is from Kmart, it actually says 86 on the tag, but we know from the front it's 1989, so that might be the production run of when it started. He still has his original, check that out. That's pretty awesome. That's old school right there. Still got all the tags, still has his beanie. It's in good condition. No major stains, but the back, which is, that's, you know, reasonable. We're gonna pull comps on him, that might be something. See, I don't know nothing about him, but I'm gonna look him up regardless. I'm not gonna say, well, it was cool, but I'm just gonna let it go and look him up. What do you have to lose, a couple minutes? What happens if that's like a new product where I can always find it and I start seeing them everywhere? If there's money to be made, just add that in your memory bank of something you could flip later. Goods, there's always money to be made here. Vintage tennis rackets, racquetball rackets, golf bags. So depending on the season, whether you have, if it's like summertime, people are going on cruises, snorkel fins, snorkel masks, snorkels themselves. I like anything baseball. I like catcher's mitts, gloves, especially if you can find other hands. Left-handed or right-handed gloves are super hard to find, but people like them because they're broken in. When you buy a brand new mitt, it's super hard. It's not going to be flimsy enough to get some real good feel for it, so people like things like that broken in, and they like particular styles that they're used to. It fits their hand perfect, and they're looking for that same style. Bike racks are good. I haven't done too well with hockey goods. I haven't really dove in head first into that. I come across it a lot, but it's not really, I live on the West Coast. It's not really that huge over here as far as like kids playing in the streets. But what I have been getting on is the backflips are crazy. Certain bats, you're gonna know the size, the weight, the style. Most of them are gonna be written on here for you guys. So I like Louisville Slugger, Easton. Even ones that are crazy colors, teams like to represent their colors, and the crazier the colors, to me, the better. I also like vintage skates. Rollerblades do really well for me. The old school ones with the crazy colors, like the neon yellow, the greens, the purples. People like I said, my age group, kind of the 25 to 40 group, they were raised on those rollerblades. They wanted them, but they were super expensive when they came out. Now that they can afford to get them, go back to their childhood, or they're going to vacation on the beach or something. They want to cruise up and down. That's the way to go. The rollerblades, blue wheels, and I like that these aren't the buckles, they're the laced ones. Really good condition too. Look like they never even skated in. Equipment. I love finding vintage cassettes, anything that they don't make anymore, but it's still a technology that people use. I like cassettes that are still new wrapped, VCR or VHS tapes, CDs, like the actual CDs that you burn. You can find those unopened, those are good. Also, if you can find Trapper Keepers, those are like the holy grails. You can find those, they're awesome, they're a quick flip. I look at for Rolodexes, these right here. Chest holders, like storage cases, go for big money. Don't be scared to buy larger items that you're scared are gonna ship. You can still flip them locally. People will pay for stuff like that to be shipped because you can't find it anymore. Calculators, Texas Instruments are huge. So I like the TI-83, TI-84, those are the graphing calculators for higher math. It's so you know what I mean, right? So those calculators can go anywhere from 70 to 100 bucks. Usually you can sell them for 50 plus used. If you have Amazon and you're not restricted, those go super fast. And kind of learn school schedules. So if it's the beginning of the next semester, so usually the semester starts about this time, January or whatever, people are gonna start buying this stuff. They're gonna start buying textbooks, calculators. So you wanna have those things in supply ready to go. And there's nothing wrong with buying items and stockpiling them and waiting so you can get a higher price. So just because you buy graphing calculators, say in November, doesn't mean you can't hold on to it. And then when January rolls around, you can charge a higher premium because now they're in demand. Rolodex. I'll sleep on Rolodex because I still use them. Computer ink and printer ink. If it's unopened, check most comps, but if it's unopened and you're getting it for cheap enough, chances are you can flip it. Film as well. For land cameras, you can find vintage film. People still, when they stick to a particular fragrance, whether it's shampoo, lotion, conditioner, body wash, they're very loyal to their brands, and a lot of times they'll get discontinued. Even if it's open, people still pay top dollar for certain items, especially perfumes. So even though if it's pops and it looks like it's been used a couple of times, or even half the bottle's full, don't be scared to pull up comps and check on them. Old school reading glasses, especially the frames. If they're made anywhere in Europe, Italian, you can tell by the frames on the inside of the actual lenses. No, what are they called? The holder thingies.
Frames.
Inside here, these are obviously not a pair that I would be interested in. They'd breed right here, and they'd have like the style code on either side here. What you want to do is you definitely want to make sure that the frame size fits correctly, and that, you know, you can always tell that if it's high quality. So make sure you're on point. Remote controllers. Especially the older the TV, the better. You can find remotes for cheap enough to pick up old school remotes, pull the cops. Printers. Always look for printers. Check the style comps again. Don't be scared to ship bigger items just because they're bulky, just because they look like they're going to be a task. Why would you ship 25 items to make $100 when you can make $150 on one item that'll take you an hour?
You're looking for inkjet printers?
Again, there might be seasonal.
Gone out yet?
You can pick them up for super cheap. They have particular scents. Again, even if they're burned a little bit or used, people are so scared that if they're partially used that people don't want to buy them because they're not pristine or they're not brand new. Couldn't be farther from the truth. Certain candles, like Yankee candles, if they discontinue a scent, somebody's super particular about that one particular scent. They don't care if it's burned down an inch, 2 inches, whatever. They can still get that scent going in their house. You have it and they don't have it anymore. Supply and demand. When you're representing that mug life, shout out to Gary Vee. I've been flipping mugs forever. Vintage glasses as well. Starbucks, Dunkin' Donuts, people are religious about their coffee. Religious about where they get it, so why not maybe just as stuck on and locked in with their actual brands that they use as well. I like finding vintage ones though. I like the porcelain ones, not necessarily that are cracked or chipped, but that they tell a story. Maybe your grandparents used to have the same set, and you're like, I'd love to find that mug. I totally remember from grandma's house. Find them all the time. My grandma was English, so she always had Princess Diana coffee mugs. Every now and then I'll find one and be like, what you know about the 92 Bulls. My brother is still a huge Bulls fan. That'll probably be money. We'll pull that up. Might be like a $15, $20 glass. When you find one, always look for others. So usually it's four to a set. If they have multiple, just a better margin for you. These are $1.19, so for the two, it'd be $2.38. Would turn it for maybe a $15 glass, now it could be like $30 for the two. I like book ends. Shelf, you know, to hold books in place. The heavier and the cooler design, the better. Sometimes you find rare ones or super intricate style ones that took a lot of time and finances to make them. But I don't see any of that. Artwork. I think one of the most slept on categories because there's a lot of fakes. So you gotta be careful as far as if you're gonna sell some vintage artwork, just because it says Picasso on the paper print does not mean it's a Picasso, and it can get you in a lot of trouble and get you kicked off of your account. Huge things to look for, certificate of authenticity on the back, frame. Sometimes just the frame itself can be worth hundreds of dollars. The picture in the middle can be worth squat, but the frame itself, super detailed, can be worth some money as well. So scroll.
when you scroll through, like I said, frames are super important, styles.
I also like finding, you find pictures of like model cars, Harley Davidsons, particular sports teams, maybe they put them in a real nice poster or frame. So this is obviously, I don't want to say custom, but it is a hand painted.
It is a tchotchke job too.
But stuff like that is still pretty cool.
Bikes.
Always keep an eye out for vintage bikes. If you find a GT Mach 1 from the late 80s, early 90s, go ahead and give me a ring. I'll sweep that mug up real quick. Old school dynos, GTs, Robinsons, chrome Schwinns. I don't really do like the 10-speed, 12-speed old school bikes like that. I like the old school like racing bikes, BMX racing and stuff like that. Those are super cool, super high dollar amount. Saw a GT Mach 1. It was a, I want to say an 88. You can look up comps. They go for like $700-$900 sometimes, over a grand. They have all the original pads. The padding is super important. So if you actually have the original GT pads that go over the handlebars and frames, that's crazy. So that's pretty much a tour of how I kind of shop through. I didn't go to every single aisle and every single area, so it's kind of to teach us young. If you have a particular niche, I say focus on your niche, so that way you actually have a step up on the competition. You can automatically have things you can resell. Always expand your knowledge. There's nothing holding you back from researching items, from researching souls, which is what we're gonna do. But please like and subscribe if this helped you out. If you have any questions, go ahead and leave a comment down below. Shout out to my boy Ethan the Heathen for filming this for me. But this is a Flippin' Genius.